tonight. An armed carjacking took place in the Hart today, with police making two arrests. Plus, local police are facing challenges with gangs from the Lower Mainland having a presence in Prince George. And a local conservation group has found that a company continues to harvest old growth, despite a promise not to. Good evening, folks. I'm Eddie Huband, and welcome to CKPG News. Our top story tonight is yet another violent crime on Prince George streets. It was a chaotic and frightening morning on the Hart Highway earlier following an armed carjacking. Two people were robbed of their vehicle on the Hart by two men with firearms near North Kelly Road at around 1 a.m. this morning. Tommy Osborne was on scene and brings us this report.
This was one of two arrests Prince George RCMP made Wednesday morning. The huge police presence on the Hart Highway, right beside the Hart Center, was because of an armed carjacking that took place at around 1 a.m. Both suspects were arrested at around 9 a.m., and while the community can breathe a sigh of relief, this is just one of many crimes Prince George has seen since the new year.
Are you able to reassure the public in Prince George that it's safe to live here?
I can reassure the public that police are working night and day to try and apprehend and track down those that are responsible for many of these violent crimes that have been happening within our city.
Right behind me is where one of the suspects was arrested early this morning. And for the full picture of the crime, police say there are still many details to be worked out. For example, the victims, were they just innocent bystanders? Police don't know the answer to that yet, but they did say during the interview process that it was a very distressing experience for them. Or does this carjacking have any relation to the increase in crime we've seen since the New Year's? Again, police say they are working on finding the connection between this carjacking and other crime, if there is any connection at all.
For community members seeing the increased crime, it certainly isn't pretty. But at the end of the day, they do feel that Prince George is still safe.
I feel safe up here, yes, in the community up here. But I'm aware of my surroundings now. I don't have to worry. I worry about, what's going on.
I feel pretty safe about the whole thing, but, you know, I mean, anything can happen at any time, right? And that's the gist of it these days. It is increasing in the bowl and a little bit in the heart, but not, I don't think feel like it's too dangerous up in the heart here. But the chronic crime downtown should be addressed in a better way.
Springwood Elementary School was placed on a hold and secure as a precautionary measure, as it's located close to the crime scene. At the moment, Prince George RCMP aren't releasing any further details. Tommy Osborne, CKPG News.
Tommy Osborne joins us now to follow up this very frightening story. Tommy, you were down at the scene today, heavy police presence. Can you just tell me a little bit about what went into making those two arrests that we just saw?
Well, yeah, heavy police presence. There was six police cars down there.
Wow.
taking up two lanes, all the sirens going. You couldn't miss it. You know, I was driving down there, gone to the parking lot. Of course, everyone else sees it. So a lot of people are pulling over on the side of the road. They want to see what's going on. People pulling into the parking lot want to see what's going on. People leaving the grocery stores. From like the bystander viewer perspective, it was quite hectic. A lot of people pulling their phones out, pulling over, just wanting to know what's happening. But as far as the officers on scene were, they handled it very calmly. Of course, you know, they were perfect. Like, so the viewers, very hectic. The officers, very calm. They got the job done, from my point of view, perfectly.
Very interesting. There's a helicopter involved as well, correct?
Helicopters and dogs.
Right. Oh, yeah. It's definitely quite a big incident that happened out there on the Hart. So, you know, I noticed that you talked to a couple community members. You know, we've had a lot of crime, as we've been reporting on our show in recent weeks. What is your sense about how the community is feeling about all this? I know that those two gentlemen, said that they do feel safe, but do you sense that there is a little bit of tension right now in the community?
There definitely is a little bit of tension. As you did see in the story, there are several community members that say they do feel safe, and that, of course, is fantastic that we feel safe in our own community. But I also spoke to a lot of people off camera just when I was shooting B-roll, when I was on scene, and I got this general sense of frustration,
right,
exhaustion. You know, people want to feel safe in their communities. A lot of us do, which, again, very lucky, but there's just this sense of just fatigue with all this crime that's happening. It's been ramping up since New Year's. I mean, just last month, also also in the Hart. We had the Husky gas station there was also robbed at gunpoint again. So we're seeing a lot of this gun activity. People are getting frustrated. They want to see some action to hopefully see crime go down. But again, there is also a lot of people saying that they do feel safe. So that's great to hear.
All right, Tommy, thank you very much for your insight on this. And we will continue to follow up the situation as it continues to unfold. And in the midst of the recent crime incidents, council heard a lengthy report from the local RCMP detachment earlier this week, part of which described a disturbing new trend that has reappeared in the city involving gangs from the Lower Mainland that are operating here in the north. Cheryl Jan has more now on this troubling report from the RCMP.
As council heard Monday night, gangs from the Lower Mainland are making their presence known in our city.
The game is still the same. The players might be different, and the new group is coming up. I think what a bigger trend, though, is how open they are about it. You do enforcement action, you execute a search warrant, you seize drugs. These individuals are spoken to by police and interviewed, and within short order, somebody else from the same group is up here in no time.
The news was particularly unsettling for council, but gang activity is not new to our city.
Remember back to 2009, 2010, we had a shooting downtown. We were named the most dangerous city in Canada, and the gangs were real trouble then. And the RCMP focused significant attention on it and brought that down and more under control. Now we see it's on the rise again. As the superintendent said, it's time to buckle down.
Last week, Prince George's RCMP's street crew unit announced it had led multiple investigations targeting individuals and groups involved in trafficking drugs. Search warrants were executed in various residences throughout the city, resulting in substantial seizures of illicit and prescription drugs, as well as cash.
Well, we made national news with the drug bust that happened here. So the fact that the bust happened means that resources are on the ground and they're doing the work that they need to be doing. So we've got to thank the RCMP for the hard work that's being done, but there's a lot ahead of us.
What concerns law enforcement is the sheer blatancy with which the gangs operate. Untouchable?
I wouldn't speculate as to that. I just think certainly it's lucrative. And a day you're not selling drugs is a day you're not making money. And huge amounts of money.
With the report, council was presented with a laundry list of priorities for this year, including gangs.
The preventative work, the education work, the sometimes just officers going down and being aware, having the situational awareness so they know what's going on. But we've really expanded on the data resources.
Garth Rozelle says information is power in the fight against crime. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
In other news, a local conservation group and their partners have found that the company Drax is sourcing logs from old-growth forests, despite claims to the contrary. Adam Burles has more.
Conservation North, along with the Buckley Valley Stewardship Coalition and Biofuel Watch UK, says that they have found that throughout 2023, the company Drax obtained logs and chipped wood from priority deferral areas, which were designated as the rarest old-growth forests in the province. According to the group, Drax continued to procure old-growth forest wood for their BC mills in January of 2024. In 2022, BBC's Panorama and the CBC's Fifth Estate found that Drax was logging old-growth and other primary forest in BC to make pellets.
We discovered that Drax was getting some raw material from priority old growth deferrals, which means that these are the very rare old growth forest types in BC that were identified and mapped by a technical group a couple of years ago.
Drax takes the fiber from the forest to turn into pellets, which in turn get sent overseas.
What we discovered is that contrary to some of Drax's claims of sustainability, in fact, they're sourcing some of the logs that are coming from old growth forests here and turning them into pellets. And of course, these pellets get shipped to Japan and they get shipped to the UK and they're burned for electricity.
MLA for Prince George Mackenzie, Mike Morris, says that while old growth is vital to BC, due to sustained logging, there is very little old growth left.
It's vital. It's the lifeblood of British Columbia. We have logged so much in British Columbia now that we have very little old growth left, if you want to put it that way, or primary forest or those large trees. That's been the focus of the forest industry now for decades.
According to Conservation North, a Drax representative claimed in a recent radio interview that Drax stopped sourcing logs from old-growth forests in 2023.
We extended our analysis into January just to test that claim, and we discovered that, in fact, at least 100 loads of logs came from old-growth forests in January of 2024. So we're not sure that they've stopped obtaining logs from old growth forests. It's very possible that they're continuing to source those logs from old growth forests.
In a statement to CKPG News, Drax says that they are aware of 9 truckloads containing material from old growth deferral areas that were mistakenly delivered to Drax's sites and that they do not source fiber directly from harvest sites. Adam Burles, CKPG News.
The District of McKenzie has signed a partnership agreement with internet service provider CityWest to bring high-speed fiber optic connectivity to the town. Funding from the federal government of $3.1 million will cover the cost of the high-speed internet to over 1,200 households, and the remaining 720 homes will be funded by the district and City West, who will equally share the required additional investment of $2.2 million.
We have been sitting on this news, waiting for the government to announce this funding, and we've been promising the community high-speed is coming. And we are very grateful that the residents of this community have been so patient waiting for this, but it is going to be a game changer. The plan is to have shovels in the ground in late April when the ground thaws, and we will have crews in the community working on the underground fiber optic cable. So every home in the town site will be fiber optic to their home available to them.
In other funding news, the province is offering funding for farmers whose orchards and vineyards have been decimated by extreme weather. David Eby says farmers will get an extra $70 million through the province's perennial crop renewal program to replant and strengthen their crops. Wine grapes growers and Okanagan fruit growers say a cold snap in January destroyed the majority of the province's harvests. That came after another crippling deep freeze in 2022 and wildfire smoke damage in 2021. It's Social Work Week, and as is tradition, the local social work community handed out a special award in honor of a true trailblazer. Here's Cheryl Jan with more.
Bridget Moran was a force to be reckoned with in her day.
She wouldn't take no for an answer about things. She really tried to organize, to change the way that things were done within social work with reference to kids, with reference to Indigenous communities, and she ended up getting fired for it.
And she is an inspiration to aspiring social workers all across the province.
Well, I went into social work right out of high school. As a teenager, my family went through a big loss. And the support I received in our community based in just like a very wraparound approach. And that's actually what got me through high school. I ended up going to an alternative school. I saw counselors and all those things. And I just kind of realized, like, this is what I want to do.
And as part of Social Work Week, the Northern Branch of the BC Association of Social Workers awarded the Bridget Moran Award posthumously to Jim Campbell, accepted by his daughter and his wife.
Jim has been a fixture in social work for many, many years, in many ways. He is a member of the BC Association of Social Workers, very active in our Northern Branch on the executive. Also, though, very active in the Board of Registration, originally the Board of Registration, now the College of Social Workers.
And for many, understanding what social workers actually do is something of a mystery.
We are everywhere in health, like, you know, not just Northern Health, but in the community, the frontline agencies in the community. And actually, you know, for me, the thing that drew me to it was about social policy. And so that's my passion, is social policy.
How about a little arts news now? Miracle Theatre's newest production, A Comedy of Tenors, is kicking off tonight. Despite the name, A Comedy of Tenors is not a musical, and it will be performed every day except Mondays, going until April 3rd. It'll be performed every night as well. Every year, Miracle Theatre raises funds for various charitable causes, and this year, all the money raised is going towards a wildfire structural protection unit. Now, this can protect up to 75 homes from incoming wildfires. And while the fundraising goal is quite high, set at $180,000, the equipment could be literally life-saving for our community.
It seemed especially timely, given that they are predicting this could be the most serious wildfire season ever. And we were very impressed and concerned with what happened last year. And as one person put it, we might be one lightning strike away from becoming another Kelowna or Shuswap or, Lord help us, Fort McMurray. So I think every community should think ahead and have equipment like this on standby.
And just a quick note, you can buy tickets for the show at Books & Company, either in person or by phoning. Tickets are $37.50.
Last week, the Prince George RCMP seized more than 10,000 prescription pills from criminal gangs that came from BC's Safer Supply Harm Reduction Program. While most of these prescription drugs are meant for addicts with a very high tolerance, they can be lethal with even one dose when sold to youth or others who are not chronically addicted. Then there's the issue of expanding the scope, impact, and profits of organized crime, not just in BC, but now in other provinces. You can guess how Alberta feels about the large quantities of BC government's so-called safe supply of drugs ending up on the streets of their towns and cities. Here in BC, over 2,500 people died last year, over six people every day from drug overdoses. The problem is getting worse, not better. It's an epidemic of disastrous proportions. So, is the current BC government's approach to this problem working? Many would argue it is not working. Would taxpayer funds be better spent on high-quality rehab, where people have at least a chance to change their lives for the better, or more social housing to put a roof over their head and get them off the street? Again, hopefully closer to other in-house services like counseling and healthcare, and therefore a better chance of success. And while those on the far left are quick to label anyone who criticizes the current harm reduction program as uncaring or unsympathetic, this is narrow-minded. We should also be considering the harm that our small business owners are enduring, or families that want to support the businesses or use the services and amenities in our downtown, or tourists that feel extremely unsafe, or police officers and ambulance and hospital staff who are dealing with this issue on a daily basis. If you ask them, the situation, again, is not getting better, but only getting worse. Another way of looking at it is, we don't provide taxpayer-funded free alcohol to alcoholics or free cigarettes to smokers. In fact, the government spends a lot of money to get people to cut down or stop doing those things altogether, for obvious reasons. Maybe it's time the BC government applied the same logic to the drug crisis. I'm Chris Beach, and this is a Northern View.
As of this morning, the lowest gas price in Prince George was sitting at $1.549 per litre at Costco. The lowest price in the province right now is in Salmon Arm at $1.529 per litre. Manitoba currently has the lowest fuel prices on average in the country at $1.326 per litre, while BC has an average price of $1.798 per litre.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Feed your team tonight with a delicious mix-and-match combo. Chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
The Prince George Cougars are back in action. It's a rare midweek game tonight. They travel to Kelowna to take on the Rockets. The Cats have been very successful against the Rockets this year, going 5-1-0 in their last seven matchups this season. It's going to be the last time these two teams face each other in the regular season, though. Kelowna does enter this one on an eight-game point streak, winners of their last five games in regulation. Prince George, meanwhile, they're currently on a 13-game point streak of their own. Their last regulation loss came all the way back at the beginning of February. Both teams come in red hot into this one. Should be a great matchup. Puck drop goes for 7:05 at Prospera Place, Kelowna.
You know, I think we should be proud of what we've accomplished, especially in, you know, the last 13 games. It's not easy to go that long with losing in regulation. And, you know, we've pushed hard and really tried to take a step forward. So, It's helped our team a lot, and especially going down the stretch here in the playoffs. Kelowna's a good team, and they've been playing some good hockey lately, and you know, we're in their barn tonight, so not an easy barn to play in, but we're prepared, and we're looking to start this road trip off right, so it's definitely important to get a win.
So we talked about the volunteers and the Paranordics already, but one of the places at the ski club that needs the most volunteers is the biathlon range. And to talk about it more, Caitlin Pobersnick was down at Caledonia earlier today to give us the lowdown.
First official day of the Paranordic World Cup Finals here at Caledonia Nordic Ski Club. I'm joined by Sir Ian Hartley, Chief of Range here. We were talking about the importance of volunteers. I know we've had a lot of biathlon talk, but we're on the biathlon range right now.
That's correct, yeah.
You guys have more volunteers than anybody else. What's up with that?
We sit with between 50 and 60 volunteers per competition.
Oh, wow.
And it's just the amount of work that's done on here, it has to be choreographed and it has to be looked after carefully. You're recording the athletes shooting and their targets and how well they're doing, and that all has to be done electronically as well as on paper. So each line needs to have somebody. So we have a group of volunteers that do course recording. We have a group of volunteers that help set up the range in the morning and tear it down in the afternoon, grooming, all of that. So it's a lot more out here than somebody who's on course control or doing stadium. Not to take away what they do, but the number of volunteers is just incredible here.
Now, before we even did this, you got paged to get somebody else to go do something
else.
It's like, it's almost like there's different levels that go along with it as well.
Very much so. And everybody looks to me to make sure that things are the right way. So I have somebody that helps me, who's an international referee and also part of what's called jury. And so they make sure this is all national level as well. And we're doing a really good job here.
Now, what makes this range even able to use? Like, what are the qualifications that you guys have to have for people to be able to come and be a part of this biathlon range?
One of the biggest things that we have is we can generate snow, and there is snow for our competition. And over the last couple of weeks, as everyone knows, we have the challenges with being warmth. But then as soon as it dropped down cold, we were able to make snow and push it into the range. And this range has to be very level. And so we have the groomers out and we make sure every night that it's all level, the mats are level, and it's fair and equitable for all the athletes.
That was a big thing that everybody's been talking about too, is the weather. That's a major part of what everybody's saying. So there's no worry on your end though right now. It looks like it's pretty good. There's still snow. The groomers were out here. It looks really good this morning for everybody to start. So no worries on your end yet?
Not yet, no. Yesterday we lost about four centimeters of snow. So we had a lot of volunteers out leveling and pushing snow around to make sure all the mats are up to the red boards. That was the thing we had to do. So you're pulling snow out, and we're all here till late in the afternoon doing this. Jackets are off, making sure that it's a fine course and it works. It's a lot of work.
Well, awesome. Thank you, Ian, for joining us.
You're
and
welcome.
We have, again, some more races happening today and for the rest of the week. We'll keep you updated as the week goes on.
The TSX is up 139 points to close at 21,970. The Dow Jones is up 38 points to close at 39,043. And Artemis Gold went up 2 cents to close at $7.85.
Good evening again, everyone. We are looking at a slight chance of showers around the midnight hour tonight and into the overnight period. Very small chance, though. And then tomorrow morning, we could have a little bit more of those clouds and showers lingering. Southwest winds tonight gusting, and then they'll switch over to those southerly winds through the day tomorrow up to about 40 kilometers an hour. And that's going to bring in all of that warm air we've been anticipating. So quite unsettled up towards the north coast today. You can see it there. And so a little bit of that trickling through our region. Very small chance, though, as you can see, there's not a lot showing on our future cast. So that's for tonight and tomorrow for mostly the early half of the day, but primarily we're going to really focus now on all of that warmer air pushing up from the south as we see the winds shifting to a southerly flow, and that will bring in some really, really beautiful temperatures. Even tomorrow, 11 degrees for our day tomorrow. So we're into the double digits under mainly clouds, so not a lot of sunshine just yet, but it is coming our way. We are going to see beautiful sunny sky with this ridge building. Already down through the southern interior and the Okanagan in and around 10 to 15 degrees there. South coast and inland towards the lower mainland looking wonderful the next several days. Lots of warm weather coming. Still a little bit unsettled up towards Prince Rupert and inland to Terrace, but things will dry out right across the board going into the next few days as that ridge really moves in and strengthens. So 12 degrees in Quesnel, 9 in McBride. We'll get a little more sunshine up through Quesnel or down through Quesnel and up through Vanderhoof tomorrow. But really most of the other areas of our region will be under fairly cloudy skies, at least for the early half. There's the potential for a few breaks later on in the day. 8 degrees for Edmonton tomorrow. Foggy in Regina. Winnipeg will be cool but nice and clear for the day, and then looking at some sunshine over towards the eastern half of the country as well. Our weekend is going to be warmer, it's going to be sunnier, it is going to be absolutely lovely. You might even want to break out your shorts. I don't know, we'll see. But yeah, all of that warmer air, it's very, very warm and unseasonably warm down across the U.S. border at the moment. But yeah, a lot of that coming our way over the course of the next few days. So -5 overcast skies tonight for Burns Lake. You're looking at highs of 7 for the next few and then bumping up to about 9 and 10 degrees for the weekend. The sunshine doesn't really make its way in until mostly Friday. That's when we'll start to see the really clear skies and that big transition to a drier trend. 0 with overcast skies tonight in Mackenzie. Cloudy tomorrow, sitting at 7 though, and then an increase in temperatures and conditions looking great as the days go on. Sunday and Monday, this is also potentially stretching into early next week as well, this ridge of high pressure. So we could be starting the week off next week under some really nice conditions as well. McBride, -4, mainly clouds. Lots of cloud cover tomorrow. Milder though, and then even milder than that going into Friday, Saturday, Sunday looks like the strongest point of this system for you. Quesnel looking at highs of around almost 20 degrees by the end of the weekend. We'll be sitting very similar to that as well, and you'll see it here. So again, up to about 16, 17 degrees by Sunday. Saturday, Sunday look to be pretty warm, even into Monday as well. So beautiful sunny sky. We do have some clouds to contend with before that. Slight chance of showers tonight and into the morning tomorrow. Overcast skies tomorrow for the most part, but we're into the double digits, 11 degrees. And then we see the ridge take hold and the clearer skies are on the way.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Feed your team tonight with a delicious mix-and-match combo. Chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Caitlin Pobersnick joins us now with the latest from day one of the Paranordic World Cup Finals down in Caledonia. Caitlin, let's start here. What are the medal situations looking like so far after this exciting first day of events?
Well, Eddie, if anybody was paying attention to the first week, they would have seen that Ukraine took the lead with that. So no surprise that, again, Ukraine is in the lead after day one. 8 total medals for them. 8 medals, 3 gold, 3 silver, 2 bronze. That is going to be hard to beat in general. Next closest is Germany at 6, followed by Korea with 2. Canada is in that 4th spot with 1. That is Mark Renz. Again, no surprise. He was the flag bearer for a reason in the opening ceremony. Swept last week. I assume he's going to sweep again this week, getting gold in his event for today.
Yeah, and Mark winning by a large margin, almost a full minute in that race. Now, you spoke to Mark, as you said, last week. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about his story.
He's been everywhere doing everything. When he was at his last Olympics, Paralympics, he swept. He got 6 medals and the 6 things that he did. He was the first time flag bearer this time around. Usually he's the guy that carries the flag at the end of the tournaments, which is a big deal. If anybody's watched even just the Olympics itself, usually you get deemed the flag bearer for the closing ceremonies for a reason, and he has always had a reason to be the closing flag bearer. So I assume he might be in that position again this time around too, because he is just a really great guy. He's done everything. He's been to Pyeongchang in 2019. He's done a lot of stuff, so.
Interesting. Now, in terms of the rest of the week, as we move forward in this event, what do we have to look forward to here?
Again, we finished biathlon. Today, we're going to go into cross country as the week goes on. Again, everything finishes on Sunday, so the next few days, a lot of tired athletes. I'm going to assume a lot of athletes were doing the parabiathlon last week and are now continuing their athletics this week, so I can only assume that by Sunday, if they've been doing 2 weeks of athletics, it might be a very tiring last thing for them to do. But you know what? They get to go home, rest up a little bit, right, and then get ready for some summer sports.
Interesting stuff. All right, Kaylin, we'll continue to be covering the event all week at the at Caledonia. Kaylin Theron, thank you very much for that. Stars making their impacts last night in the NHL and MLB. All in tonight, CKP3.
Starting with a Shohei dinger.
Padres after that, then the Padres have the day game the next day and the Dodgers at night. Ohtani hits a high fly ball deep left field. It is back. It is gone. A two-run homer. Shohei Ohtani. 6-0 Dodgers.
Ohtani continues to dominate for his new team as the Japanese superstar crushes another home run in spring training. Next, battle of the expansion teams.
Here come the Kraken, Burakovsky, Larson Burakovsky, great stick, Petrangelo. We go coast to coast, through center it's Eichel, he's in alone, he scores! Jack Eichel ends it with 1:59 left in overtime.
Vegas and Seattle exchange chances in OT before Jack Eichel buries the OT winner in one of the more exciting games this year. Finally, Bedzie has 20.
Hawks just not letting it get out of the attacking zone. Foligno and Bedard. Kurashev, Bedard, one-timer score! Like you
A beauty one-timer gets Connor Bedard his 20th goal of the season. The rookie phenom also recorded 5 points last night, which gives him 51 in 52 games, as Bedard's performance takes top spot in tonight's CKP3.
Hello from the CKPG Today side. The Shamrock is right behind me there. You know what that means? It's Shamrock Week. It continues here on the show. And today we're going to talk about getting lucky. Now, not getting lucky to win the lottery. We're talking about, you know, the love edition of this. Christina Biancini is going to stop by, tell us about how you can maybe get lucky in the dating scene if you're in that kind of sort of stage of life. And the four-step guide, essentially, to getting success. How about you over there? You're going to utilize these four steps? Maybe you already have. I bet you can name a few of them.
Well, you know what they say, Caden, a gentleman doesn't kiss and tell, so I'm going to leave that one at that. to finish up today, ski waxing is a big part of the Paranordics. Athletes can't perform without them, obviously. Caitlin Popperson explains what waxing really is.
Wax on, wax off. That's a daily behind-the-scenes occurrence. Every day, every athlete's skis need to be taken care of, and that's exactly what Ian Daffron does.
Waxing basically is trying to make the skis as fast as possible. So we use different waxes, different ski grinds, different structures on the skis to try and make them, you know, as quick for the athletes as we can. We know that if we do our job and make the skis really fast, that helps the athletes to, you know, make it into the podium.
The technicians figure out what the best wax is for the condition of the course, similar to how a caddy in golf chooses the best club to use, depending on the circumstances.
What we do is we test a lot of different types of waxes. So we'll go out, probably test anywhere from 10 to 15, maybe even 20 different types of waxes every morning before the race. And we'll choose the best wax for the day. In the end, it's me that makes the final call. So I make the final call on the waxes and the skis that the athletes will use. So if they have bad skis that day, then it's my responsibility or my fault. We always have a saying is that you're only as good as your last race. So every day we have to work harder for the next race to make sure that, you know, we have good skis for that as well.
Just like Daffron, many wax technicians were once competitive skiers.
For myself, I was on the Canadian junior team back in the late 80s, so a long time ago. And it's kind of a natural progression from going from an athlete into waxing.
When working with athletes, Daffron has to earn trust because if something happens to the skis, well, all eyes are on him.
Athletes and ski technicians really got to work together and, it's really important that they have a good relationship and they have a high level of trust between the two of them.
Working on skis doesn't stop after winter finishes, as many athletes take on similar competitions throughout the summer that involves related skill sets. Caitlin Poversnick, CKPG News.
All right, folks, that's all for now. Thanks so much for joining us as always. And your last look tonight is more scene from Caledonia. Enjoy your night, and we'll see you tomorrow.